Here.
Counsel Amaral. Counsel Cotzaw.
Here.
Counsel Chapel.
Here.
Counsel Jordan.
Yeah.
Counsel McLaughlin.
Here.
Counsel Pearson.
Thank you. Would you all please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next on our agenda this evening involve the minutes of meeting number 9, held November 13th, 1991. What is your pleasure?
Mr. Chairman, I'll move they be accepted as printed.
Second that.
Mr. Chairman, I have a concern with that. And under correspondence received, where it's talking about the letter we received from Dr. Rand, it says he stated his displeasure with a town council vote stating that a member of the Conservation Commission may not serve concurrently as a member of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. I would like to see that corrected to say concurrently as a member of the directors of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. I think it's important that we correct that. And I did finally dig out my letter from Dr. Rand and find out that's exactly what he had said.
Great, and I think that was the very issue we were voting on that particular one.
Add that revision to the minutes and then be glad to support them as they, with that revision.
We have that one correction noted. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Passing. Thank you. 5-0. At this point in the agenda, we have a item entitled Citizens Discussion of Items Not on the Agenda. At this time, I would invite any of the individuals in the audience this evening to come down to the podium to bring up any particular issue that may be on your mind. We'll be happy to listen and do our best to hear you out. Is there anyone who has an item this evening that is not on the agenda and would like to speak to that issue? Seeing none, I will close that portion of our meeting. At this time, we move to reports and correspondence, and I will be happy to begin this section with a couple of items. I have a note in front of me here from the town manager indicating on December 2nd, 1991, Mr. McGovern received a call from Senator Mitchell's office in Washington indicating that the United States Coast Guard authorization bill had been enacted by Congress and was simply awaiting the signature of President Bush. It is anticipated that the President will sign this particular bill. The legislation contains a provision requiring the Secretary of Transportation, whoever he or she will be, to convey ownership of the Portland Headlight property to the town of Cape Elizabeth. This action would not have been possible without the active intervention of Senator Mitchell. And at this point, I would like to publicly thank Senator Mitchell for really his efforts over the last 2+ years on a variety of occasions and supporting the town of Cape Elizabeth at every opportunity he could with respect to getting the ownership of Portland Headlight. As I indicated, this is simply awaiting the directive of the new Secretary of Transportation. I would also like to publicly thank Senator Cullen, who also has been very helpful with respect to his intervention on this particular issue. And as long as we're thanking Senator Mitchell for lighthouses, we ought to also publicly thank him for the in excess of $134 million in the recent transportation bill that will allow Maine to substantially fund the new Portland-South Portland bridge. Another piece of information I would like to address is the issue of the fundraising campaign with respect to the leadership committee's work at the museum at Fort Williams. I wish to remind citizens that indeed there continues a community fundraising campaign that is underway to preserve the Keeper's Quarters at Portland Head Light by creating the museum at Portland Head Light. I'm sure most of you here and in the TV audience have received the mailing that went out about this particular project. The campaign is off to a very good start, but we do urge each and every household to participate at whatever level you find appropriate. Each and every contribution really means so much as we work as a community to create an engaging museum that will both educate and entertain. The story of Portland Head Light and Fort Williams will come to life for this and future generations at the museum, and it will be a true source of community pride. Particularly at this time of the year, in December, many families are making year-end decisions about which nonprofit donations they might make at the end of the year. Individuals want their donations to have a major and lasting impact, and we thank all of you for considering the museum at Portland Head Light for a donation that will create an outstanding new educational resource for our community. Thirdly is a letter that I have just skimmed briefly from Ann W. Van Lockhuizen from 1009 Shore Road, and the substance of this letter was to state her opposition to the so-called Shore Road Shoulder Improvement Project, and I'm certainly willing to go into greater detail when we discuss this item at our budget portion of the agenda this evening, but suffice it to say that she is opposed to the so-called Shore Road Shoulder Improvement Project. And lastly, I will just mention that sometime, as yet an undecided upon date in January 1992, we will have a formal open house, so to speak, in dedication of 1226 Shore Road and the Public Works new addition. As of yet, that date has not been established, but we will let the citizens know as soon as we have decided on an acceptable time. Well, that's my contribution this evening. Hopefully there are other reports and correspondence at this particular time.
Mr. Chairman.
Counselor.
The RWS board met twice since our last meeting of the council. November the 14th, we took up contracts with the different towns, and then a very interesting meeting on November the 21st of the Finance and the Building Committee, and most of the town managers were invited to it. With the economy the way it is throughout the Northeast, why the tonnage that was planned on for this new building in Gorham is way down. We're going to have a feasibility study of the project, and it may be necessary to even go so far as to cancel it, or at least scale it back until things improve. It certainly isn't going to be built with any of the town's dollars in it or guaranteed to it until it's a workable situation where it pays for itself and doesn't use our tax dollars to stay operating. A very interesting meeting. I'll keep you informed, Mr. Chairman, as that goes along. The Cape Elizabeth Town Center Committee has met twice also since our last council meeting. On November the 14th, we had kind of a round table here in the chambers, and gosh, I wish we'd had the attendance we've got tonight. It's wonderful to see all you people out there. I don't know why you're here, but it's wonderful to have you. The second meeting, December the 4th, was a meeting to approve our goals of the Town Center Committee and to dispel all rumors that we're going to spend any money. The idea is to get a plan in effect so that we do not make mistakes as we go along and do something in one area or the other that isn't in the overall plan. And it was very well received after the people found out that we were not going to spend any money. I think that's going to be the name of the game as we go along. And we started our inventory of all the buildings, trying to go back 5, 10, 15, and 20 years. Who was in them, what type of a business, and what have we got now, to give us a feel of the whole thing as we talk this Route 77 of ours that goes right through the middle of our town. While I'm talking about it, just one, if I may, thanks to Maureen O'Meara, our planner. She has been outstanding and a great help to the committee. We're very fortunate to have her. Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor Chapel. Counselor Jordan, did I see your hand, or, no, excuse me? Excuse me. Other reports, Counselor McGlaughlin.
That was the ladies.
I can touch that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was in attendance at the Executive Committee of the Greater Portland Council of Governments last month. We had a very informative program about property revaluations, entitled Property Revaluations, How to Handle the Process and the Fallout. And I think with the recent fallout that they've had in some of our neighboring communities, you cannot imagine how informative and helpful this was for the rest of us. Our speaker that evening was very well versed in the subject. It was our own assessor, Jerry Daigle, who was filling in for somebody else who was tied up with his own counsel that evening. And Jerry spoke very eloquently about what he terms tax equalization, and I think that's something that would behoove all of us to keep in mind when we're talking about revaluations, that it's a way to equalize the taxes, the tax burden on everybody in the community. Is that fairly accurate? The next meeting of Greater Portland COG is going to be next Wednesday night, the 18th. They are going to be having an open forum discussion about public works in your town, which will be headed by Dana Connors, the Commissioner of the Maine Department of Transportation. I invite anybody who's interested in public works to get in touch with me or get in touch with COG and certainly attend that meeting. It's also a meeting where newly elected council members, such as Councilor Chapel, are invited. I would also extend the invitation to any other members of the Cape Council who may have questions about COG. It's a good night to come and find out what COG is all about and what kind of relationship COG has with its member communities. I had a bunch of stuff here. Wait a minute. Just to let the rest of the councilors know, the manager and I have had a very preliminary discussion with me in my capacity as chairman of the Finance Committee. And I had clipped from the newspaper an article that I will see that the rest of the council receives in the very near future from one of the Sunday paper, the David Broder's column, entitled A Town Tries to Break Democratic Deadlock. This was about a town in California that had sent out a questionnaire to the residents of the town to obtain help for the town officials and the councilors, or however, whatever their system is, in setting their budget priorities. And I think that's something we may very well want to consider here early on in our budget process so we have good citizen input. The citizens will feel that they have a chance for input early in the process. It's the kind of help that the councilors and as Finance Committee is going to need this year. I have spoken with Charlie Greer, who's chairman of the School Board Finance Committee, and he and I were in agreement this was something that we very well might want to pursue. So look forward to that. Just a couple of questions to the manager that I had posed to me by citizens. One about activity, I would say, at Building 326 at Fort Williams. There are lights on late at night this weekend. And the other concerning minutes from the Recycling Committee about their location of the second bin at the IGA. Their minutes indicated we would see something about it tonight, and I'm just curious about that.
Yeah, on the first issue, Building 326 is the larger of the two offices row buildings, and it is currently leased to Day One, a provider of substance abuse counseling and other related services. They're a tenant of ours and will occasionally be using the building into the evening. On your second question related to
recycling,
it wasn't quite ready for council action. Bob Malley, the Director of Public Works, and I had a meeting with Carol Fritz and Carol Eisenberg this morning. Carol Fritz is the chairman of the Recycling Committee, and Carol Eisenberg is the head of recycling for regional waste systems. And we are progressing on it. It looks like it's something that will happen and will be on your agenda next month for you to take final action on one way or the other. The pending issue, and one reason it wasn't ready, was we were looking into whether or not a pad would be necessary. And if so, we wanted to figure that into a budget for you.
Thank you.
Other reports and/or correspondence? Seeing none, we will close this portion of the agenda. At this time, I would like to announce our first public hearing this evening on shoreland zoning amendments and the zoning map. This is item number 100. It is to consider public hearing comments on proposed amendments to the shoreland zoning ordinance provisions and on the proposed zoning map, and take any necessary action. In a moment, I will defer the presentation this evening to Councilor Cogsill, the chair of our ordinance committee, but also alert the audience that our town planner, Ms. Maureen O'Meara, is also in attendance and will be called upon to help out in explaining any of the more technical aspects of the amendments, and she will be assisted by our town attorney, Tom Leahy, who is also in attendance, sitting in the front row. So at this time, I would like Councilor Cogsill to present the issue, and then I will open up the issue to public comment.
Thank you. This evening for public hearing, we have a shoreland zoning amendments package, which is a completely revised shoreland zoning ordinance. It includes expanded and more inclusive definitions, and it is part of the state mandatory requirement that we adopt shoreland zoning regulations by December 31st or January 1st. Under the ordinance, section 19-1-3 is definitions, 19-2-1, 19-2-8-02, and continues for 32 pages and concludes with section 19-4-7. We are also asked to adopt the map which is before you. There are two amendments to that map. There were new areas in town after checking the soils map that indicated they should also be mapped as resource protection of one kind or another. And another area was eliminated that was previously mapped. Is that correct, Maureen? Change that. As well as on further research that the heavy line around the wetland area that abuts Brentwood area should not be a heavy line because it's not considered by the state to be of high or moderate wildlife value.
Thank you very much. For any of you present this evening who had hoped that Councilor Cogsill was going to go through this line for line, I'm sure you're disappointed. It's quite a tome, it's quite a document, and I suspect that most who have come here this evening have come to address particular sections of these proposed amendments. Ms. O'Meara, would you want to say anything at this particular time before opening the issue to the public, or would you want to wait until hearing some of the comments? What would be your pleasure? It might be helpful if you just spend a few minutes, perhaps in as global a fashion as possible, just outlining some of the major issues that may find themselves to be more controversial this evening.
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Certainly.
So somebody could get that map up in the air so these people can see it without in front of you or hanging up somewhere.
But these amendments are based on a requirement by the state. Very early last year, the state adopted new shoreland zoning guidelines and requiring all communities to update their shoreland zoning or to adopt new shoreland zoning, which complies with the state minimum requirements. What the state has done is set up a series of minimum requirements, but has also given towns some latitude to adopt regulations that are in keeping with the local character and local, special local situations. In Cape Elizabeth, the major special local situation is that there is already an existing wetlands ordinance in place. When the state adopted shoreline zoning, it expanded the area that it would cover, where originally it would cover areas within 250 feet of tidal waters, lakes, and rivers. It now also covers areas adjacent to wetlands and also areas adjacent to streams. In addition, they are requiring that a certain amount of significant natural areas, namely wetlands, have to be zoned resource protection. So in working with the planning board and with the ordinance committee, the attempt was made to change the existing zoning ordinance of the town of Cape Elizabeth as little as possible, to tinker with the existing wetland regulations to make them come into minimum compliance with the state. In doing that, there are some areas in our ordinance that's proposed tonight that may not meet the specific letter of the minimum requirements of the state, but as a package, they meet the intent of protecting these areas. Some of the major changes are that there is now a minimum 75-foot setback that's being proposed from tidal waters, whereas before in town, the setback in many areas was 50 feet. So that's a major change. Something you may want to keep in mind is that we are dealing with state minimum standards. So when possible, I think that there's been an effort by the planning board and by the council to adapt those standards to local conditions. But in some cases, there's really very little room for movement. If we sent an ordinance up to the state that had a setback of less than 75 feet, I believe that would be a red flag that this may not be an acceptable update to meet the state's minimum guidelines. I'm here to answer any questions.
Thank you. I think at this point, Mr. Leahy, do you have any comments that you would like to make at this time?
I'll be brief, just noting that the amendments are to be adopted by the end of the year, and this is a December meeting, so I thought I should just advise. I looked at the state statute, which provides that the existing ordinances that you have continue to be valid and in effect until you adopt a new ordinance or new amendments in compliance with the guidelines, provided that after January 1st, the state can step in and take the affirmative act of imposing their state-mandated requirements on you. So it's not like on January 1st, they arrive and they're here, and I don't anticipate you're not going to do it and get these adopted, but I just wanted you to put this in context that your ordinance remains, it's effective after January 1st, but the state after January 1st can come in and make, impose upon the town an ordinance that would be in compliance with their minimum guidelines. So I think that's effectively what I want to say. The second point is if any of the provisions are found to be inconsistent or less stringent than the state's minimum guidelines, then it's up to the commissioner of the Department of Environmental Protection, who has 40 days to review it, to respond and say why it's not consistent or not as stringent as, failing which, they're effective. So you would normally adopt an ordinance. It's effective 30 days after your adoption. In this case, is a twist. And the twist is these amendments must be approved by the commissioner of the Department of Environmental Protection. And it just gets into niceties of what happens if it's not. I don't want to get into all that. Basically, he could make amendments to make them consistent with the state provisions, or presumably simply impose the state minimum guidelines. So I don't want to stop on a negative note. I just want to tell you the context that I think these are presented to you tonight. So I understand that they've gone through the planning board and the ordinance committee, and I guess Maureen and I are here to help answer any questions that come up in the public hearing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leahy. Before opening up the public hearing to the public, I just want to make a couple of comments. I have received a number of phone calls myself with respect to the issue of this shoreline zoning amendment item. What I don't think we can do tonight is address each of your specific land-holding concerns. What I think would prove to be futile would be if each and every one of you who are here for this issue came behind the podium and said, well, I have this piece of land, and if you do this, this is going to happen to that. I would very much encourage you to let us know how the new amendments would impinge upon your ability to build a home, to change the home that you have right now, to force you to perhaps put in a foundation sooner than you had wanted to. But I would not anticipate us getting into a debate back and forth about would it be acceptable or not acceptable under the new amendments. What we want to get tonight as a council is as much input as possible from the public in terms of how much is this going to impinge upon your specific circumstances without getting into a debate this evening. So having said that, I would at this time open the item to the public and ask if you would be kind enough to come to the podium, state your name and the address where you live, and to at least as much as possible offer us your comments as succinctly as possible. Who would like to begin? Please.
Good evening. My name is Ralph Bianco, and I reside at 9 Pine Point Road in the Brentwood section of Cape Elizabeth. My purpose in speaking to you tonight is to ask that the Town Council not adopt a shoreland zoning ordinance with its present boundaries at this time. I believe that this ordinance is overly restrictive and presents numerous hardships to the affected landowners. There needs to be additional study so that the Town Council can understand the full impact to homeowners. I have had an opportunity to speak to each one of you, with the exception of yourself. I wasn't able to get back to you, but thanks for calling. To kind of convey how this impacts certainly myself and many of my neighbors. In those discussions, I try to stress to you that I am not an environmental terrorist, and I certainly do not think that we should not protect our wetlands. But I think we need to keep in mind something called reason, and to fully understand the impact in terms of resaleability, the value of our homes, and so on. I believe that there needs to be more study, especially in light of what I perceive to be the inadequacies of the previous notifications on this issue, the last of which being the article in the Cape Courier, which, again, speaking for myself, does absolutely nothing to prompt me to think that I am in a critical wetland. If I looked at the last one, it simply says, shoreland overlay zone includes all areas within 250 feet of the tidal waters and wetlands. Where does this apply to Ralph Bianco at 9 Pine Point Road in Brentwood? I certainly don't think I'm in a tidal zone. I certainly don't think I'm in a wetland or critical wetland at that. Or prior to just a few weeks ago, a rated critical wetland, the highest protection given to wildlife. You know, right up there with all the great national parks in this country, in my backyard. I have a tough time with that. In preparing to speak to you tonight, I did so with the hope and understanding that I would be dealing with reasonable and rational people, and that you would be genuinely concerned about how this impacts your constituents. The way I found out about this was purely by accident. And I guess I find that rather irritating itself. And every time I spoke to someone, everyone's trying to hide behind the cloak of, I did what the law said. I published a notice. I put it in the classified ads. I didn't give people an opportunity to really stimulate their creativity and think that they were in a wetland. I consider that inadequate notification. But the way I found out about this is, again, I said by accident. One of my neighbors was attempting to sell their house, and they inquired about clearing some brush, clearing an area, moving a fence, altering the property. And they found out that they were in a critical wetland. And that's how I found out. I say that's no way to find out about an issue that's so critical to us all. In my weeks of looking at this, I have nothing but praise to say to the people I spoke to. I think everyone gave me a tuned-in ear. But what I did see was a definite lack of a clear, consistent understanding and interpretation by the town's official as to how this ordinance affects people. It's my understanding that the boundaries were established by aerial surveys. You have to remember that my property on this map right here is about a quarter of an inch square, if even that. The felt tip markers that mark this here is like half my property. I say that's inadequate. You can't look down and say that's a critical wetland. I think you have to do some on-site investigations and confirmations. And if you say that's too expensive, then let's grandfather these boundaries. This is my house you're talking about. This is my American dream that you wish to take away from me. You're telling me I cannot extend my property. I can't put a sunroom on. I say that's an effective condemnation of the use of my property. I can't put a doghouse behind my house if I chose to. I wonder if I could even put up a swing set. I wonder if I had a fire, would you allow me to rebuild my home? It's my understanding that in some areas in Wells, there were some damages, and they won't let these people rebuild their homes. Does this apply to me as well? I'm told by some that if I did not have a sump pump, I can't pump out my basement. I can't put one in. Is this really true? If it is this not ludicrous? Should I not be upset? I believe that the spirit and intent of this law was not to stop me from adding an addition to my home, or from putting in a swing set or altering my property, providing drainage, or something like that. That doesn't mean I'm going to go out there and put a 10-story skyscraper on, but I'm talking within that word reasonable again. And yes, I do know that I can build up, but I have no intention of putting a sunroom on the second floor above my bedroom or something. It's my understanding that the Cape is going beyond the spirit and intent, or I shouldn't say that, beyond the state mandate. It's not clear to me as to exactly which areas. I get varying views, and I need more time to study. And since I need more time to study, and I think you need more time to study and assess impact, I think you can't vote on this tonight. You can vote. I don't think you can accept it tonight. I believe that if you buy off that this is an issue, and I've heard a lot of discussion tonight about this is a stamp mandate, Ralph, we have to adopt this tonight. Well, I think the state, I think, are reasonable people, and I think that they ought to hear that the way we establish the boundaries in densely populated areas needs to be reviewed. You can't come in there at the stroke of a pen and say, sorry, guys, we're changing the game midstream, and yes, 20 years ago when they built Brentwood, we gave those permits, but we're changing the rules of the game midstream, and you can't build your little extension, or you can't put your doghouse out, or you can't put your tool shed out there. This is how it affects me. This is how it affects my neighbors. I believe that the Cape, if they're truly concerned, can act as my advocate with the state. Go to the state and say, we erred here, or we're going to make a mistake. I think we need to take a look and see how this impacts these people. Be my advocate. Cape Elizabeth calling the town, the state, and saying we need to reevaluate this here is a lot different than me calling. I mean, them and the Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife, we don't have a chance. So I really think that there's some leeway in the December 31st deadline. I think that we can, and I'm sure we could succeed in extending that date if we give them due cause, good reasons. Clearly, I'm concerned about the value and the resellability of my home. In the end, after all avenues have been exhausted, my sense is that if I'm sitting on swampland, then tax me as swampland. Give me a rebate on my taxes. And I hope that we can reach these conclusions without any litigation of these issues. I don't think litigation helps you or helps me. It's my understanding that people have litigated thus far. I don't want to follow in their footsteps, but you can't expect me to roll over and play dead as though this isn't going to infect me, and it is. I've also found out, and I need to confirm this from other sources, and perhaps, Janet, you may know better than I, that the city of South Portland is negotiating with the state on those boundaries. The city of South Portland is going to the state and saying 250 feet does not make sense in this densely packed area, and they're talking to the state, they're negotiating. And I think that that would make perfect sense in these areas. That's all I have to say.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bianco. Who else would like to address the amendments? Please.
Good evening. My name is Robert Howe. I'm with the firm Terry and Architects, and I represent Dr. Nelson on Shore Road at 890 Shore Road. Dr. Nelson came to us with a predicament a few weeks ago. He, like the previous speaker, found that all of a sudden he was concerned, or should be concerned, with some restrictions that were going to be placed on some property which he owned, and perhaps limit what potential use he could make of it. We have addressed a letter to the chairman and town council of Cape Elizabeth. I would like that to be entered into the record, if I could ask that be done on Dr. Nelson's behalf. I won't go through the letter line by line, but there are a number of items here that we list that would impact upon his particular piece of property. Again, I don't want to review those. They have some, again, some place some severe restrictions on what he had hoped to do with the land. Later on, we in the second page of the letter, there were some suggestions by our firm as to perhaps how you might look at more densely populated areas, change some setback requirements there. There is some also a lack of clarity and precision between the amendments and the existing zoning ordinance as far as how it's read. Terminology seems to shift. And speaking quite frankly, as we read through the amendments and looking at the ordinance, it's decidedly a difficult piece of read. I would encourage people of Cape Elizabeth to think that you could perhaps get something that has a little more conciseness to it, its clarity, and people could go to and read a little more readily. I'm not going to go over particularly the items that Dr. Nelson is going to find that would be onerous to his property, but I think, again, that the like the previous speaker, you need the time to readdress perhaps not the specifics, maybe, but how it's approached. Maybe some of the items need to be looked at in light of the more urbanized corners of your town. And wait, and perhaps the timing isn't correct right now. I can't believe the state, in its present confused condition, wouldn't bend a little bit and think more carefully about what you're going to propose for them. So I would recommend to the council that time be given to look at this thing more carefully. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Howell. Others? Please.
Hi, Diane Carroll, 1 Pine Point Road, in the Brentwood section. I guess I just have a couple of questions. What I don't really understand is how they come to the decision, the state or the town, or that you go and you buy this piece of property, and you know you have your rules and regulations, but they're okay because you knew that when you bought the property, and then suddenly, by accident, as Mr. Bianco said, you're told, I've been told, that I can't even, when my addition was put on, that I cannot even fill in the backyard where the dirt was put out and reseed. And I guess I'm really pretty confused about that. And that, I mean, I'm being told I'm going to break the law if I do that. And I guess I feel very strongly that this is something that our property lines should be grandfathered. You know, this, we were resource protected when we moved in, and we thought that was terrific. And, you know, we need to protect our resources, but I don't see how I'm going to protect any resources by not seeding in my backyard and having my kids slip and slide all over the soil that's out there. And we're really very concerned, and we're very concerned about the notification. You know, we feel that, you know, if we were going to do something that affected you, then we have to notify you. you know, we have to get our proper permits and do everything just right, or we're picked up on it. But to find out something of this magnitude, you know, purely by accident, and I think a lot more people are going to find out. I don't think a lot of people really have the understanding of how this is going to affect them. And that's really about all I have to say, except, you know, Mr. Bianco mostly summed it up. But thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Carroll. And I do see our town planner and town attorney both are taking down notes. What I'm suspecting is that at the end of the public portion of this issue, comments will be made to try to address similar concerns rather than stopping at each juncture. I hope I'm assuming correctly. Others?
I'm Dean Stearns. I live at 5 Penwood Circle. That's down down in Brentwood West, what I thought was beside of the swamp where I lived for 15 years, but I guess it's wetlands now. Mr. Chairman, manager, and councilors, I'd just like to say that I think if this goes beyond the absolute state mandate, then in essence the town is confiscating part of the property value that those of us that are affected. And that if that happens, that I think the town should have every expectation that we would expect a commensurate reduction in valuation and taxation. And I guess all of us enjoy our little common area down there, and I think we're environmentalists as well as anyone else. But I would certainly urge the town not go one iota beyond the state mandate, which is possibly goes beyond where it should. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Stearns.
My name is Bruce Johnson. I live at 76 Brentwood Road, and I have no idea whether my property is affected. I'm really here as a matter of principle to raise some questions and to ask you for further consideration of the issues presented by the whole ordinance. I'd be curious to know from the town attorney whether the state has the authority to essentially zone Cape Elizabeth. I'd be interested in knowing whether that concept has been judicially tested and clearly determined. It seems to me that if it does not, this may be an appropriate time to take a stand on that issue. I have no idea what the answer to the question is. It also seems almost unbelievable that it takes 32 pages to say what's in and what's out on the map. Do I correctly understand this ordinance is 32 pages long?
That is absolutely on the money.
Obviously, there's an implication in my question. I haven't read it. but if it takes 32 pages to say what's in and what's out, I guess I kind of wonder if that's really good government. We're going to need a battery of interpreters. Most of them usually wind up having licenses to practice one profession or another. Kind of leaves the ordinary folks in this room out. It seems to me like more consideration is needed. I'd appreciate it, as Mr. Bianco said, if this group could become an advocate for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth with any state agency which is trying to say whether the Carroll's house should be landscaped in the backyard. I bet you they've never been on Pine Point Road. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Other individuals. We've certainly heard from Brentwood. Please.
Well, this is my first time in front of a camera. My name's Don McKinney. I'm also live in Brentwood, but that just made me think that I hope that other people in the other parts of the town will realize that they are also affected by this ordinance. I guess I have to confess my ignorance. I did not know until a few weeks ago that I was in a critical wetland area, that if I sit in my living room, that I'm violating some ordinance. And also, I'm concerned about the fact that my property rights, that I feel like I had when I bought the property about a year and a half ago, are no longer there. I'm certainly an advocate for resource protection and protecting wildlife. I worked very hard for a number of years on other planning boards to do just that. but I don't ever recall saying that someone who had bought a property that was an approved building lot of an approved subdivision, approved by this town, and I guess to assume that was that would be approved by the state and the federal government, and also that those rights would be taken away without proper notification. I think that if I was going to add on to my house, I would have to notify my neighbors of what I was doing so that any impact on their property would be known. I think the impact on our properties by this wetland ordinance is so great that I can't believe that each and every person who was affected by it so greatly was not notified. I guess that's about all I have to say. But I do hope that other people in the town will realize that they will also be affected by this ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McKinney. I was going to try to give everyone at least one chance first. Mr. Bianco, I'd be more than happy to have you return. Are there others that would like to have a first crack at it? Well, Mr. Bianco, please return.
Thank you. I would just like to make an additional comment relative to the submission requirements in the event that we were ever fortunate enough to do any alterations of the property. There are two types of, you get permits in two different ways, typically from the town. One is you apply for a building permit with a set of plans that are deemed to be suitable and get your building permit, assuming you're within compliance of the code. If we, however, have to go before the planning board, I just want everyone here to know that you're in for a big shock in terms of what you have to do to get a permit. And I didn't read all through the 33 pages of the new ordinance. I did get a good deal through it. But I am, however, familiar with the what's written up in the submission requirements of the current ordinance. And I want people to know that it takes 23 copies of plans to be submitted, that you have to get the soil scientists involved, and then you have to get botanists involved to find out what the dominant species is and to find out what the underlying soils are and so on. And I can go on and put you all asleep, as I have many times reading these ordinances. But let it be known that you're in for a rude awakening if we have to comply with these submissions. And so my question or my request is that if indeed we can do some alterations, I also think that we need relief from these submittal requirements and that we should go through the normal process of submitting our intended work through the code enforcement officer without planning board review. Thanks.
Thank you. Please, Mr. Thompson, come on down.
I'm Tim Thompson, 6 Pine Ridge Road. Notwithstanding a lot of the testimony that we've heard today about the Brentwood people that are so affected, I think one of the things, the only thing I would like to say is that at this point where we've got this opportunity in Cape Elizabeth to at least enact an ordinance that is at least state guidelines, that we shouldn't, for the future, based on how this is going to impact some of the people that are already in homes, in residences, that we shouldn't even consider doing anything less than at least state ordinance. I'm surely not proposing that we do anything more stringent as it would affect people in residences as has been talked to about earlier, but we have an opportunity now to protect future wetlands. We haven't done a nearly a good enough job in this town or in this state or in this country to protect wetlands. There are states, California's got 90% of their wetlands are gone, Iowa's got 90% of their wetlands gone, states throughout the country that their wetlands are almost eradicated. And we've done a very poor job as a state in this region protecting the vital, critical wetlands that are left. There's tremendous pressure nationally at the federal level to go the other way. It looks like federal legislation is going to be pushing less and less stringent protection of the wetlands. And notwithstanding how it's going to affect many of our people that do have existing residences on lots, hopefully there is some relief that they can receive. But as it relates to future development of properties, which, you know, sooner or later, we're going to get out of this economic slowdown, recession, whatever people want to call it. And then we're going to have that pressure again to pave over and fill in and further eradicate our wetlands. And so I would strongly encourage us to enact protection as stringent as we can. However, I wouldn't suggest we go any further than what the state mandates are requiring. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. I see a hand in the back.
Herbert Dennison. I don't live in Brentwood, and I live on a rock pile, but I feel sorry for these people in Brentwood and anybody else that's bought property. And then suddenly they can't go out and put a drain or Cool Lady Cedar. It's another, in my opinion, infringement by the state. I don't know how they come in and zone a town, and I think you people should look at this, the way the financial problems are, and understand from our representative over there that this has been on the table now for 2 years, and all of a sudden we're under a deadline, and I don't think you should pass anything to these people who have some rights. And I think all people like that should have some rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dennison. Others who wish to speak to this issue? Okay, at this particular time, I will close the public hearing to the public, and I would ask at this time if our town planner, Ms. O'Meara, might be willing to at least address some of the comments, if possible, and I'll give permission for our town attorney to follow up in whatever capacity you feel that might be helpful.
What I'll try to do is just address some of the specific issues that were brought up. I think something was talked about the need for more on-site work and on-site investigation. And perhaps I should have mentioned that at the same time that the town is going to be looking at adoption of the package of amendments, they're also going to be looking at adopting this map right here. This map is supposed to have pretty much the same boundaries that we have right now in terms of where the wetlands are. But it's improved in some ways in that it's supposed to be easier to read than it used to be. One of my favorite things about this map is there's a note line that says the zoning map suggests the location of each resource protection zone, the actual boundary of which is subject to field verification. In the wetlands ordinance at this time, without passing the amendments, there is a page and a half procedure that talks about how to identify the wetland boundary. So the town has already acted on that and agrees that absolutely, you know, this is the best we can come up with based on the information we have available. But more on-site investigation is definitely needed, and that is done on a case-by-case basis. As someone comes into the town hall and requests a building permit, the first thing that's done is that there is an effort to verify where the wetland boundary is. In most cases, what happens is the code enforcement officer will go out to a site, and between the code enforcement officer and the landowner, there will be agreement as to where the wetland boundary is and how far away the building or whatever project is being proposed has to sit away from that critical wetland edge. If there isn't agreement between the landowner and the code enforcement officer, then there is some burden on the landowner at that point to start providing some additional information. But there is a procedure in the ordinance right now that does provide for on-site investigation. And the fact that there's a note on this map to state that on-site field verification is necessary, I think everyone is in agreement that we're trying to use the best information we have, but that we can always improve and get a better feel of what's going on there. There was some concern about if someone had a building in a critical wetland area if they would be able to rebuild if it was damaged or destroyed by fire. Under both the shoreline zoning and under the existing wetland regulations, if you have a building that's destroyed by fire, you can rebuild it up to a year later. So there is some provisions in there for allowing someone to rebuild a structure that's damaged or destroyed by what you might describe as an act of God. There was some comments about whether or not you would be able to place a doghouse or some other thing in your backyard. The way the ordinance is currently stated, if you are in a critical wetland, and again, that has to be determined by some field work, whether the soils in your backyard actually are very poorly drained soils. But if you are in a critical wetland, then there is no expansion of the footprint of your building allowed, and that's under the existing ordinance. You're allowed to expand the living area by up to 25%. So that would allow you to add a room on an upper floor, but they wouldn't allow you to do any more construction on the area that you have already worked on. There was some concern about the conciseness of the ordinance, and I agree, it's long. I've spent a lot of months with it, and I wasn't happy with it either, but it's a lot shorter than what the state gave us to begin with. So there is one change I would suggest, and it part comes from our efforts to keep the existing ordinance as much as possible and just to amend where it was necessary. There is, in the definition section of the existing ordinance, a definition for the normal high water mark, and that should really be called the normal high water line. But that's something that would more clearly refer back to the definition of normal high water line, which is the term that is now being used by the state, and where we've amended everywhere we found it, the ordinance, it was missed in that section. There was a question about reseeding an existing lawn as part of an addition, and the existing ordinance does allow, even if you're in a critical wetland, the grooming and maintenance of existing lawns. And I'm not familiar with the specific situation, but it seems that if you wanted to do work on your lawn, that's already provided for as a permitted use in the critical wetland zone. There was some concern with notification. I can tell you, in terms of the shoreline zoning, that there was public hearing notification at the planning board level. There was public hearing notification for this meeting. Anyone who was located in a Resource Protection 3, which is a new resource protection zone, and anyone who is located in one of these wetland areas that are located, that are blue, purple, received specific notice mailed to their home. In addition, there were articles in the Cape Courier, and those are mailed to every resident in town. So in terms of the shoreline zoning, I believe that there was an effort to notify people of what's going on. There was some concern about whether this ordinance goes beyond the state mandate. In my professional opinion, it does not go beyond what the minimum requirements of the state are. There are some specific places where last year when the town adopted wetlands regulations, it was more strict than it currently is. But there are also places where we deferred to the existing local regulations that may not be quite as strict to what the state is requiring. So I believe there's some give and take in here, but on a whole, it's meeting the minimums and not going any further than that. There was some concern about people who are living in critical wetland areas, and again, if you're already in an area, whatever you're doing currently, generally you can continue to do unless you're doing something particularly obnoxious to the environment. There's nothing that prohibits someone from repaving their driveway, from mowing their lawn, from washing their car, anything like that. It's the particularly obnoxious things that you might not be allowed to do anymore. But if you're already there, the ordinance allows you to continue doing whatever you're doing. So if you have a house, no one's going to make you tear it down. There's also, I guess, one question about sending things to the code enforcement officer instead of the planning board, and that is a policy decision on the council's part, but I think whatever entity makes those decisions is going to need a minimal amount of information in order that the decision that's made is fair and consistent over different people's property. I don't have any notes of any other questions.
Mr. Leahy, did you want to respond to couple of more legal issues, perhaps?
The one matter I can respond to in a little bit more detail was that presented by Mr. Howe on behalf of Dr. Nelson. His letter to you asks for three considerations. One, that the town not adopt a 75-foot setback from high water line in the ocean, rather 50-foot setback. Two, that the maximum coverage of a lot be increased from 20% to 25%. And three, that the definition of high water line be amended. And basically on that issue, he states that your present ordinance defines it one way, minimum guidelines a third way, and the proposal is a third way. So we have three potential high water line definitions, and I think in essence he felt that for his purposes the prior one was better and he'd prefer that. I think that's a matter of just, I think all three are fine, the state minimum, your present, or the proposed. I don't see them to be substantively different. There may be some interpretations under the old. It had the highest effect of the tides as opposed to the normal high water line, and that was apparently an issue. The two other points, 50-foot versus 75-foot setbacks or coverage of a lot, these are stated very clearly as state minimum guidelines, and I tend to agree with Maureen O'Mara's comments earlier that when they're that specific on those requirements, it'd be a red flag to fly in the face of those with the state. I want to point out for both Maureen O'Mara and my part, we're not here to defend the state's ordinance. This is mandated. We've had a shoreland zoning ordinance mandated by the state since I think 72 or 74. So we're not all of a sudden getting a new mandate. I think it's a valid act by the legislature. If somebody contests it, we'll find out. It's been on the books in 74. Point is that we've had some substantial amendments by the state now, and they're causing more concern, but this isn't new. We've had it in the Cape ordinances for quite a few years as well. But again, I'm not a defender of what the state's mandate. I'm just trying to help this council, I guess, decide whether to adopt these amendments to comply with that state mandate. I would point out there have been a couple comments of can this be less restrictive than the state? There's at least one area that I think it is less restrictive, or put another way, more protective to the property rights of Cape Elizabeth residents, and that is we have grandfathering provisions. They've been alluded to. Maureen is correct that if a house is destroyed, there's a right to rebuild. It presently exists. It will exist under these amendments, and there's some limited expansion possibilities. We've gone a little bit further from the state, and I hope the state finds it acceptable, and it's consistent with what this council did with the wetland provisions that were amended in May of 1990, and that is we have continued to try to grandfather approved subdivision lots which were approved by the planning board applying the then existing wetland provisions, and those are contained in 19312. And so we've gone a little bit beyond the state grandfathering provisions to specifically address those subdivision lots that have been approved and have been tested or approved in light of the existing wetland alteration provisions. It's limited for 10 years, but it would begin to be 10 years from the effective date of this ordinance. So I think there's an example where the planner working with the planning board and the ordinance committee have decided to try to keep something we've already had, something we thought was a protection of property rights to the extent we can. We'll have to see if the state has any quarrel with that, but we hope they don't. So I think I've tried to address those that Maureen did not cover. I think on the Bruce Nelson particular property, those are really two out of the three requests are very specifically addressed by the state minimums. The third one's a definitional issue of high water line, and as counsel to this body, I don't have a strong view. There are three possibilities, one was chosen, and you know, basically that's all I can state on that. I'll be glad to answer any questions from members of the council.
council.
Thank you, Tom. Well, we've heard from Councilor Cogsall presenting the issue this evening and had an opportunity to hear from eight of our neighbors with respect to their concerns. Our town planner has offered the best answer she can to the concerns that were brought up this evening, and our town attorney has added his comments. In the context of our discussion this evening, it would seem as though we have about four options to choose in the context of this issue. The first is to adopt the amendments. The second would be to not adopt them and let the state do what the state will do. The third would be to refer this issue back to the Ordinance Committee and continue the public hearing in January. A fourth option would be to table the issue this evening, refer it to an entire workshop of the Town Council, and again continue the public hearing in January at our January 13th meeting. Those are the four options that come to me, at least, to be thinking about as we debate this issue. If there are more options, please enlighten me. Let the discussion begin, please, Councilor Cogsall.
I would just like to ask Ms. O'Meara. You just talked about another amendment about the high normal high water line or mark. Can you clarify that?
In the existing zoning ordinance, the definition section, is, as I said, the presumption has always been to change the existing ordinance as little as possible, and to if there's two different definitions, one state, one local, and the state definition is equivalent, if not exact, we've stayed with the local definition. In the zoning ordinance, there is a definition of normal high water mark, and in the actual text of the zoning ordinance, it refers to the normal high water line. I would suggest that we take that section in, we change the title of that definition from normal high water mark of coastal waters to normal high water line of coastal waters. And again, normal high water mark of inland waters to normal high water line of inland waters. There's been some concern about the definition that's currently in the ordinance about normal high water line. The state requires that the normal high water line, and they have their definition that basically is where the water meets the land and it doesn't go any further. And that was the definition that was originally in the ordinance. But the town of Cape Elizabeth has always used a different definition. They've used a definition that relies on the top of the bank, the top of the beach, the top of the cliff, basically a more geographic definition. Staff, in particular the tax assessor and the code enforcement officer, prefer this definition because it's easier to enforce in the field, and also it has been tested and in court and survived the test. So the definition that is proposed before you is the one that the town currently uses, which is the top of the beach, the top of the bank. This is slightly more restrictive than the state. But again, it's a presumption in favor of local custom, and this is the way it's always been done. There have been some suggestions that instead of using this definition, to go with the state definition, which would be the normal high water line definition. That's a policy decision, and it can be done either way. That's really up to you to decide how you'd like to do that.
I just wanted you to bring up the fact that this is a court-tested definition at more than one time.
Mm-hmm. Other input on the nature of the feedback received this evening? Councilor Cogsall.
I just wanted to bring forward to an area where the town is perhaps being a little more lenient, which we have done in our wetlands ordinance, and also is carrying over to the shoreland zoning amendment package, is pond registration, where if someone has a farm pond or a fire pond or an ornamental pond that existed at the time of the other ordinance, it could be maintained as a regular pond and not fall under the restrictions of the wetland ordinance. We also have clarified the reason why they're registered and how they can be registered, as well as the timber harvesting.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sitting here during a public hearing this evening, I really appreciate the input that has been presented. I also appreciate the phone calls I've received and the planning board members to whom I have referred some of these phone calls. As Ms. O'Meara alluded to, the planning board did have a public, at least one public hearing that I'm aware of on this issue. I appreciate the concerns raised about notification processes. I was hoping, continue to hope, that there would be constructive ideas presented to us on how to improve our notification to people. That's something I'm still hoping for. I know we meet the letter of the law by how we do our notifications now. If you know of a way we can improve that, that is not going to be cost prohibitive, please let us know. I'm hearing concerns tonight about property rights. I think a number of people, a good many people most likely, are starting to become aware now of our existing wetlands ordinance. Concern was presented to me that this would become a public hearing on the existing wetlands ordinance. That hasn't necessarily happened, but I think this is part of the education process that we go through when we do have new ordinance language coming forth. This is an opportunity to look at what we are proposing. It's also an opportunity to look back at what we already have. And ordinances are written on paper. They can be changed. If we need to rethink some of the restrictions in our wetlands ordinance, that is not impossible, and I want people to know that. As Mr. Bianco alluded to, I am aware of the situations faced in other communities who are going through the shoreland zoning process at this time. There are negotiations going on with the state, especially concerning areas of existing residential densities. The state language was written not with the specifics of Cape Elizabeth already developed parcels necessarily in mind. They are writing language to cover the entire state. And there has to be, there utterly has to be leeway for some of the already existing situations that we have. I believe we have done an adequate job to meet the intent of the state requirements. I'm not totally satisfied with where we are right now. The chairman presented us with at least four options to consider this evening. I am not ready at this juncture to adopt the ordinance and the map before us this evening. I think it would behoove the council, and I say this as a member of the ordinance committee who has worked on this, but I think it would behoove the council to have more public input. I still know there are people out there who have absolutely no idea what either the existing wetlands ordinance impact is on their property or what the proposed shoreland zoning ordinance is on their property. Then you say to me, well, notify us. You're being notified right now. All right. It's also incumbent upon you as citizens to take part and do your own consciousness raising. If we can help you, if this evening has helped you, if it's helped your neighbors, I know the Brentwood Association has been very busy, and I'm thankful that you have been. I know people in my own neighborhood are not aware of what this is doing to their property, and we will continue the discussions in my neighborhood. That's the best I can do with that right now. But I'm hearing it's a state mandate. You've got to have it approved adopted by this council by the end of December. It's an unfunded state mandate. You probably can tell how I feel about that. The state right now is in quite a state of disarray. I cannot believe that they are going to come in here on January 2nd and say, oops, you didn't get it adopted, we're going to impose the state regulations. I would be 99% sure that's not going to happen. You never know. But knowing some of the situation in Augusta right now, I can't believe that that is going to happen. I would be horribly upset if I found that the state came down hard on this town if we delay action right now because we want to make this ordinance better fit the specific conditions of Cape Elizabeth. I think that is our job here in Cape Elizabeth. We may not be as strict as the state in some areas. We may be a little stricter in others because we already have found that it works in our current wetlands ordinance. I think there is room for negotiation. I do not think it is going to be difficult for us to show the state that we have some specific conditions that warrant changes from their requirements. I do not at all feel bound at this point by the state deadline of December 31st, January 1st, and I did not, in my understanding of Mr. Leahy's comments, feel threatened by any state action. If Mr. Leahy or Ms. O'Meara have any other indications from the state, I'm seeing him shake his head the right way. I'd be glad to hear that. There's another thought that just went in and out of the mind. It'll come back, I'm sure. I really think we need to spend more time on this. This is the kind of ordinance where I think it's worthy of us to have at least two public hearings as a matter of course. The policy is at least is one public hearing, and I've spoken to this in the past when we've had some very major issues in front of us, especially land use issues, that it's worthy of our time, it's worthy of the citizens' time to take at least two public hearings. I don't know yet, and I'd like to hear more council discussion, if I'd like to see this go back to ordinance committee or have a town council workshop. The other comment that was brought up that I would like to address is people coming to the microphone this evening and saying, well, one person told me it would be this way and another person told me it would be that way. That hits home with me because I am by profession a planner. And very often I will have people come to me and say, well, what does this mean? And I have to look at them and say, it's the code enforcement officer who interprets the language of the ordinance. Now, you can come to me as a counselor and say, well, how do you think this is going to go, Janet? And depending, I might say, well, this is how it might go, but please, please, please go to the code enforcement officer for your interpretations. Don't go to a counselor. Don't go to the town manager. Don't go to the planner for the final interpretation. That's not where it lies. It's going to be interpreted by the code enforcement officer. And if you then come to me and say, well, one of the other counselors said this is what would happen, I'm going to be a bit distressed and say, what did the code enforcement officer say to you? That's the person who has the training to do the interpretation, who has been part of helping to draft this document to some extent, has an understanding of how it's going to be interpreted. That's where the consistency in the interpretation is going to be, and that's where I want you to go for your interpretations. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor McLaughlin. Councilor Jordan.
I just want to say that, which I've said many times, and Janet just alluded to it, that an item like this requires two public hearings, and we should have the first reading and the second reading, because you have your ads in the paper and you put your articles in the courier. People don't get really upset until you have a public hearing and allow a few people to come up, the ones that want to get it started, and the neighbor kind of has a tube on and hear what's going on, and they start to thinking. And I, for one, am not in favor of adopting this evening, and I've been toying in my mind whether to make a motion to the ordinance committee or to the council, and I think that I would make a motion that we refer this back to the town council for a workshop and possibly be ready for another public hearing in January.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion on this topic at this point? Councilor Cogsell.
I just want to ask our town attorney You will do it for me, please. Through the chair. Whether or not, if the state should want to make an example of us and impose their shoreline zoning ordinance, if we would be able to counteract that when we finally adopt one of our own.
I think if the state imposes one, then any amendments thereto would have, technically would have to be done by the state because it's their imposed ordinance. I can't imagine that if we came forward with an ordinance that complied and with which fit into our scheme of ordinances, that they're going to have a problem with it. Again, your ordinances, your present shoreland zoning, wetland ordinances are valid. They're expressly valid. It's set forth right in this precise statute that mandates you to do this. They're valid until they're amended. And if you don't amend them tonight, they continue valid for this month, next month, until you amend it. And if the state never imposes any minimums on you, they're valid indefinitely. So, but precisely, I think the question is, if the state imposed an ordinance on you, can you amend it? It can't be amended without their approval. And what I read somewhere was that they have the ability to amend it, and they only have the ability to amend it because they're imposed. But practically, if you came forward and said, here's our new ordinance now, would you please approve it? I think they're going to defer to the town.
Is that helpful? Any other discussion or input? We do have a motion and a second. Could you read that over again, please, Ms. Pizzo, with respect?
It was moved and seconded to refer the proposed amendments to the Shoreland Zoning Ordinance provisions and the proposed zoning map to the town council motion.
And was there going to be then a tabling of the issue tonight to be extended as a second public hearing then in January, assuming we would have that workshop prior to our January meeting? What was your wish on that one, Councilor Jordan?
Well, I can expand on the motion and say that we can table this and refer it back to the town council for a workshop and report back in our next council meeting with a public hearing.
Is the second that would that be acceptable, Councilor Chappell? So the motion would involve it going to an entire town council workshop for further debate. Again, that would be open to the public, as all council workshops or ordinance committee meetings are always open to the public, with the understanding that the public hearing would be extended a second time at our January 13th town council meeting. Is that clear to everyone? The second is agreeing. Councilor McLaughlin.
I think people in the audience and at home need to be aware that we don't generally have citizens speaking at a workshop. And I'm wondering, I think people out there would feel frustrated to think, well, they're going to be sitting there talking about this and we can't tell them what we'd like them to think about. And we couldn't do that until the public hearing in January, which would be after the workshop. You know, I'm trying to think of this as if I were sitting in the audience. What I think would be helpful to me anyway, as a counselor, is if you have concerns about your specific property, to talk to the code enforcement officer, find out how, first of all, the existing wetlands ordinance impacts your property, and then find out how the proposed ordinance language would impact your property. I don't know if Mr. McVane would want you to put that request in writing. Is Ernie here tonight? Do you think he would want that in writing, or can people just... I want to see something in writing eventually for this workshop, I guess is where I'm headed, because we're going to need something in advance for us to look over before we have a good debate at the workshop level. And I want, you know, some of that generated. And I'm putting that burden on the citizenry who have some of the problems. It's close to your heart. It's hitting you in the pocketbook. And we all know how close that is to the heart these days. I'm asking you to help the council out, get your questions posed to the code enforcement officer, let us get some written interpretations of the existing and the proposed language so we can better evaluate where we should be headed with this. And then certainly I want the public at the next public hearing. I don't know, I'm just concerned about how well we'll be addressing some of the issues that have been brought up tonight and issues that other citizens are going to have. So I really want that kind of input at the workshop, so we'll be, I'll feel better prepared at the next public hearing where we may in fact be taking some action on this.
Councilor Jordan.
You have to go to the microphone, if he lets you.
Let me, Councilor Jordan first, please.
I think you brought up a couple of good points, but there's no reason why if we have a workshop that we can't let the public speak. So if they had some ideas at that time, but I just, something went through my mind here while you were talking there that maybe Debbie could fill us in on a schedule so we got to be ready to post this for a public hearing in January. And how many days do you need before January 13th?
To post a public hearing, it has to be in the paper as a legal ad, no less than 7 days, no more than 14 days.
So we're going to move on this if we're going to have a workshop and be able to get some public input and then get ready for a public hearing in January.
Could we, do we have to do, I'm going to get shot now, that kind of notification if we're continuing this public hearing? It depends on how substantive the changes are, isn't it?
I guess I'm going by historically when we've had two public hearings, we've posted both.
Okay.
We have a motion and we have a second. It's a little unusual to ask for public comment at this point, but why don't you, Mr. Bianco, since I know you're very involved in this issue, if you have a comment to make before a vote, be happy to entertain it.
Thank you very much. I just want you to know that I did invite the code enforcement officer to my home. The issue isn't a question of buffer zone or anything. I think Mr. McVeigh clearly said you're in the wetland. So there is no interpretation to be had. There is no discussion to be had. Unfortunately, Mr. McVeigh is bound by the ordinance. His hands are tied. It's not a matter of, well, you think there's an out here where I can put a lawn shed out back? The answer is no. It's not a question. He looked at my property and said, there's the line. Maybe it's 50 feet behind my house. And how do we establish that line? That's where the fill stopped. Dump trucks came in, filled in, built a house. That's where he thought it ended. Case closed. I would welcome the opportunity to contribute in any way that I can to this workshop, in any way. I'll leave it up to any one of you to give me a call to ask to let me contribute to that. I'll do whatever I can to get other people involved. I'll even come up with suggestions on how we can improve public notification. But I want you to know that as it affects many of the residents of Brentwood and many other residents who are home sleeping tonight, not understanding how this affects them, there's very little that a code enforcement officer can do right now if you're in the wetland. So the issue, as I spoke to Mr. McVeigh, is let's get this grandfathered, let that boundary run at the edge of my property. That's not a matter for Mr. McVeigh, as he correctly said. I have to escalate the issue. So here again, I'm poking around trying to find my inn all night here. I mean, if I'm in the wetland and if a 250-foot buffer doesn't apply, great. It's only 100 feet. I'm still in the wetland. The 100-foot buffer isn't my inn in this case. So I have to appeal to you and say that once again, we need to look at where that property line goes. But I'm not saying forgetting about new development. There is my house there already. It is our homes there. And it's not asking a lot from my little 1/3 acre lot to say grandfather my lot. So we don't have to contend with this and case closed. Thanks again.
Thank you, Mr. Bianco. We do have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion? All those in favor?
Sorry.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I just want to make sure we all think there's reasonable time for us to have a workshop before the next council meeting, before we vote on this. Is everybody able to do that?
I have no problem.
Shake your hand one way or the other.
We already have one scheduled. We'll just have to have a different topic instead of what was scheduled for the workshop on the 9th.
I'm not, again, this is, what night are you talking about?
January 9th, we had already scheduled a town council workshop.
That was the one with the school board?
The school board.
With the school board.
Mm-hmm.
Which, and they have to change that.
Well, I think we'll have to figure it out. Okay. We'll have to work it out.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I think in order to let the state know that we're proceeding in good faith, that we ought to try to do it by January. And they know that we're in the process of making a few changes, and I think it would be in the direction to head. To put it off to February, I think that would be too long. Mm-hmm. So I would hope we could come up with a date that we could get together, the most of us, and see if we could do something here. So I'll move the question.
Question has been moved. All those in favor of the motion? Vote is 6-0. Thank you very much. The second public hearing this evening involves the fiscal year 1992 budget changes. This is item number 101 to consider the status of the fiscal year 92 budget and take any necessary action. And at this particular point, I'll let everyone clear out and let our town manager present this issue. I should note at this time for all of the viewers in the homes that Councilor Amaro is not with us this evening because she is attending to state business in her role as chairperson of the Board of Education in Washington, D.C. Otherwise, she would surely be with us this evening. We wish her well in her complicated tasks during this trip. All the viewers were just waiting for the throng of citizens to exit in order to proceed unobstructed with the rest of our agenda. At this time, I will ask again our town manager to present item 101.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I can't help but think of A Tale of Two Cities this evening and Charles Dickens, and it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. I think the budget situation we're dealing with, you know, definitely is reminiscent of that. You know, we went through some very good years. We're now probably, from a fiscal point of view, the worst years that we have had as a municipality since the Great Depression. All of our major revenue sources seem to be in a free fall at this point. Our excise tax income last month was $9,000 below what had been the same month a year ago. Our investment income is absolutely terrible. The rates that we're receiving are just so low. The building permit income still remains fairly low, although there has been a little spurt of development, I think in part because of the topic you were just discussing, and folks wanting to get in front of the ordinance before anything happens. In addition to that, the major issue in our chief revenue source in the budget, other than the property tax, is the state municipal revenue sharing program. That is one that we had budgeted income of $347,000 for. The governor, as we all know, has recommended that come January 1st, the program be suspended or abolished. up to this point, the legislature has not yet been called into session to deal with the issue. It's been primarily dealt with by the party leadership as well as by the Appropriations Committee, and no conclusion has been reached. Nonetheless, last month, recognizing there was a problem, the department heads and I began a process of identifying possible areas of budget reductions. I would like to say it's been a very cooperative process with the department heads. No one likes to see their budget cut. Most of them are here this evening. They don't look too happy, and I can understand that, but at the same time, I think they've been extremely professional, and I really do appreciate all the help they have been during the process. This evening, the public hearing is on a list of proposed budget reductions. I think what's most significant about the budget reductions for the next 6 months is that within them, there is no proposal at all for the reduction of personnel. We read in the newspaper of reductions of personnel in other communities. While I cannot say that we won't have to look at that come July 1, I do think that, with some care and some particular concern on the issue, we can avoid that during the next 6 months. That's primarily because of two projects that were funded by the town council and are not yet underway, that one of which I believe should be abandoned, and a second project which has just not started as of yet. I'll briefly go through the specific cuts that I'm recommending so that everyone fully understands what they are. The major hit is in the roadway drainage account. It would be a reduction of $90,000. What this would mean is that we would essentially wipe out the entire appropriation for the year of $75,000, plus take $15,000 from the prior year's appropriation, even going back into the previous fiscal year. That still leaves a balance of $79,000 in the account, and with that, we would hope to do some work on Oakhurst Road, plus address a number of other concerns throughout the town. I think any of you have driven on Shore Road down by the fort now, you can see that needs quite a bit of work, and there are other areas as well. It's proposed that the entire town council contingency of $12,520 be wiped out. The third item is a savings of $20,000 from regional waste systems. That is divided into two parts. One is $10,000 in savings from the tip fee per ton coming in less than anticipated. The remaining $10,000 is from the fact that the resource recovery plant that Councilor Chappell mentioned earlier, that was due to be built in Gorham and was due to be completed this fall, initially to start taking waste, will very clearly not take any waste during the existing fiscal year. The next cut is the Animal Refuge League fee. Henry Brady, our animal control officer, working with the chief of police, has been able to identify a new source for taking dogs to a shelter out in Falmouth should the need arise. So the estimated cost of that is $500 for the year, as compared to the amount the Refuge League was asking, is putting it politely, requested, which was 50 cents per capita or $4,500. So that's a savings of $4,000. We have a bond that covers all of our municipal employees for theft and dishonesty. We had a separate bond that's now been combined with the MMA risk pool. As a result, we're able to save $1,500 there. Earlier in the year, we had three fire department deputies. One resigned. The position was not filled at that point. I'm recommending that the position continue not to be filled until at least the end of the fiscal year. That still leaves us would be the normal two deputies. However, as we all know, Deputy Chief Jim Murray is acting as chief at this point during the illness of Chief Webster. So at this point, we still do have a chief, one deputy, an acting chief, one deputy, as well as the three captains of the fire companies. The council had set aside $5,000 in the land acquisition fund as an appropriation this year. I'm recommending that be de-appropriated. $5,000 for a goals implementation fund, similar recommendation. Town council conferences and meetings, there was $2,000 in the budget to enable a couple of councilors to attend the March meeting of the National League of Cities in Washington, where you meet with the congressional delegation, you get updated on all the federal issues. It's proposed that that be eliminated. Some money had been set aside for equipment, refuse disposal equipment fund replacement of equipment or new equipment combined with coming up with what we may need for this Gorham project, 10,000 savings from eliminating that. Fort Williams, the budget last year was 60,000. It was cut to 30,000. I'm recommending an additional 20,000 cut, which brings it from 60,000 to 10,000 in 1 year. However, because of the nature of the projects that were ongoing at the time, that does leave with the 10,000, a total of 38,467 in the account, 28,467 from last year and 10,000 from this year. That would be used to continue the parking lot work that's in the Fort Williams master plan. The Family Fun Day Fund last year was 13,000 appropriated. This year it was already reduced to 8,000. I'm recommending a cut of 12,000, which is taking the 8,000 from this year plus 4,000 from the previous year. That does, however, still leave a balance of 99,18 in the account, which would enable a Family Fun Day to still occur this year. The office supply account for administration was 8,000 last year, was appropriated 7,000 this year. I'm recommending it be cut to 6,000. Conferences and meetings for administration, 3,850 last year. Already the budget was 2,400 this year. I'm recommending an additional $500, cutting it down to 1,900. Assessing part-time payroll, this is a savings of $820, and it would be when the clerk, secretary, the assessor's clerk, what's Sandra's title, Jerry?
Assessor's clerk.
When she is missing, she's really irreplaceable. But nonetheless, we are looking for savings to ensure that she remains irreplaceable, and that would be a savings of $820. Within the library, I'm suggesting an overall reduction of $2,000. George Rallis, the librarian, has been looking at a number of areas, and that would come from throughout the library budget. Tree maintenance last year was appropriated $16,000. It was reduced this year by $2,000, recommending another $1,000 reduction. Fire department training, recommending a $300 reduction. That is from the amount saved because we didn't send anyone to the Fire Service Academy in Emmitsburg. I was going to say Gaithersburg, but it's Emmitsburg, Maryland. That saves $300. The planning department, $800. Again, a cut from various areas within the planning department, no specific area. The police department K-9 program, a savings of $1,000. That amount, I have to confess, is a little bit nebulous. It is an area that, it's very difficult to document the cost. We are responsible for the care and feeding of Buster, any vet calls. In addition, we are required under the Fair Labor Standards Act to give Officer Steindl release time for the care of the dog. While Officer Steindl personally doesn't, hold us to it, nonetheless, there have been court cases that indicate that they can come back and get you later on. And, while I wouldn't certainly expect Officer Steindl to do that, nonetheless, that is the Fair Labor Standards Act and those are the requirements. My particular concern there is not so much the $1,000 in savings, although that is important. It's primarily the comp time that we're required to provide to him, which, then has lost regular productivity in the regular daily work. Public Works outlay, $7,800 was in the budget for some trench shoring, which is a sort of a box that you put to make sure that the sand doesn't collapse on someone. I want to emphasize that, we would not subject anyone to any danger. If we did need any trench shoring, we would rent it from the private sector. And we're not expecting to do much digging anyway, but should we do that, we would rent that instead of having our own. $500 was budgeted to contribute to the Portland Museum of Art under the budget reduction proposal. That would be eliminated. Under board professional services, $1,500, and that would be shared almost equally between the Conservation Commission, the Arts Commission, and all the rest of the boards and commissions combined, about $500 from each. And finally, board printing and advertising, $500. That's an overall reduction of $200,940. And those are the cuts that I recommended to the council last month. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. McGovern. All right, at this particular time, I would open this item, the fiscal year 92 budget changes, to the public and ask any and all individuals here to orderly come down to the podium and give us your name and title, perhaps, and your concerns. Seeing no one in a position to want to offer thoughts on this item, I will close the public hearing at this particular time and ask for discussion from my fellow councilors.
If those fellows out there aren't going to say anything, I'm surely not going to.
If I may, I don't think their lack of silence, particularly amongst the department heads here, is due to any acceptance of these cuts. I think they all realize that they would be devastating for their individual departments, and I hesitate to speak for them, but nonetheless I will. But I think the greater concern, or as much concern, is what follows this. And the council has a workshop on January 9th with the school board, and I would hope that we'll all work very cooperatively down the process, involving the department heads and the employees as well, much earlier in the process, and in a more, team approach, rather than, individually just coming in, later on in the budget process with their individual departments. I think, this is such a terrible situation, and I would hope that, everyone, principals, department heads, others would, work together as a team, recognizing each other's situations, and hopefully helping the council and the school board as you determine the ultimate fate of all the different programs.
Well, I think the reality of what has been happening thus far is that the first round of cuts by the governor did not involve revenue sharing, and so in that sense we were spared the first cuts. That hasn't slowed down the city manager in South Portland from making cuts, presuming that revenue sharing is going to get hit in terms of the next round of cuts. But it does seem to me that at least one option at this time would be to table this issue until the January town council meeting. We are told that by executive order the governor is going to be making cuts sometime before the end of this month. I think the timing tonight may not be the best timing to decide upon $200,000 worth of cuts, when there indeed may be a across-the-board cut, there may be a complete lopping of 6 months. I don't think any of us really knows at this time what the final figure is going to be, so it's very difficult to make a guess and deappropriate monies in this sort of this strange 3 weeks we're in. So that to me is at least one possibility, rather than adopting the recommended cuts, tabling the motion until January, where we have a specific number in mind at that time. That's only a thought. Councilor Cogsell.
I hope that we can consider any budget reduction in the same context as dealing with the problem of our ladder truck, whether we replace it with a used truck or a new truck. I think we have to consider those primarily at the same time.
Mm-hmm. I think that's an excellent point, with that problem is not going to go away for the town.
Yeah. On that, thank you for bringing that up, Councilor. On that point, I did have a meeting earlier this evening with Deputy Chief Gleason, who is chairing the committee on the ladder truck, and he assured me that he anticipates at this point that there'll be a report by the next council meeting, January 13th. He's nodding his head yes in the back, so. If you do table this, you will be able to consider it as a package.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It was my understanding at some point this fall that we were looking at close to $100,000 in cuts due to our own financial situation, regardless of what happens at the state level. I just want to see if that's still the situation we're faced with.
That's correct.
That makes me wonder how prudent it is to put off some kind of action this evening. The longer that action is put off, in some cases, the funds get spent and they're not there to cut. And I have some concerns along those lines. I guess I'd look to the manager and say, are we still in that situation where we're going to have to cut $100,000? And if so, do we need to do it this evening? What do we gain by putting that kind of cut off a month?
We are in that situation. However, as I look through these reductions that have been recommended, I can assure you that none of these areas will be expended. There may be some expenses within these individual accounts, but not in any way that would reduce the amount that can be cut from them. The department heads, working very cooperatively, as I mentioned before, and they're not going to go off spending X amount for Y service, if it's on this list.
Okay, I appreciate that answer. I appreciate that from all the department heads, whether they're here tonight or not. I am very, very thankful for the attitude that has been brought to this process by our department heads and by our manager. Considering some of the phone calls I've had about the budget reduction situation and some of the expenditures that this council has approved in the past year, I'm absolutely astounded that those people are not here this evening to speak to us. My hope is that some of them got their facts straight and realized that perhaps we weren't quite as out of line as they at first thought. And I'll take their absence to mean that.
Thank you. Councillor Jordan.
Yes. I think the manager has done an excellent job here as far as coming up with these cuts, as he has indicated that it doesn't really affect any one of the department heads. They all understand it, and he doesn't believe that they're going to, if we don't adopt this tonight, that they're going to figure they got more money in the bank than they had as of today. And if we need $100,000 anyway, which he indicated previously, that I don't see why we don't move forward here and adopt these $200,000 cuts right here and now.
Are you making a motion, Councillor George?
I was waiting for other comments before, but I just want to make a motion if no one else has any comments beforehand. I'll move that we adopt these cuts recommended by the manager for the end of the 1991-92 budget.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and we have a second. Is there further discussion on this issue? Councillor McLaughlin.
I'm not ready to support the entire list of cuts this evening without knowing the totality of cuts that is going to be absolutely necessary. And from what I have just heard from Mr. McGovern, I'm comfortable waiting another month to make any cuts. And I'm sure we have the full cooperation of the department heads, and I just trust that we are not going to be in a position where we're going to get stuck if we put this off for another month. I feel some kind of pressure and urgency to make cuts, but I don't see that it's really going to be a detriment to us if we wait until January meeting, see what the governor proposes by then. I think we'll be on a lot firmer ground, or as firm as possible. I feel like I'm in quicksand right now with some of this, and I'd still cling to the board for another month.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
Well, I'd just like to add to my thoughts here, as I understood from the manager and what have you, and there was no questions from anyone in the audience when he read off the list, and as he said, he didn't see where it was really going to affect anybody very drastically to have these cuts. I still don't see why we don't bite the bullet and go ahead with it, and if we need $100,000 for the remainder of this year, then we got $100,000 that we can have for the previous year's budget. We got to make them sometime, and if we can do it this way, a little here and a little there, and not get into personnel and what have you, I think we should move forward on it.
I think the town manager would like to clarify his...
Yeah, I hope I didn't misspeak. I don't think I said, or if I did say, I didn't intend to say that this doesn't affect individual departments greatly. What I intended to say is that it doesn't affect personnel in terms of there aren't any personnel cuts here, you know, whereas, you know, they are looking at that in a number of other places. But, you know, as I think I explained going through each of these items, most of these are cuts on top of cuts. They're already cut for this year's budget. We're looking for an additional cut. And, you know, we can't keep doing that and continue to provide the services that the citizens expect. So, you know, I think it's a real continued degradation of the services that are being provided and some of the backup that really provides for those services. So if I said that anything contrary to that, I'm sorry, and I meant to say that, you know, I feel good that it doesn't affect the personnel staffing levels.
But my understanding of the fact that the town heads did not address the issue tonight is basically the recognition that these cuts are horrible cuts. They're awful types of cuts on top of cuts, but at the same time, it's a testimony to everyone realizing that we have to work together as a town and we have to accept the cuts if the cuts come. If we are not going to get the 5.1% of our revenue sharing, we're all going to have to chip in, and regardless how painful it's going to be, each and every department is going to have to make cuts, and that includes all of us here this evening. Councilor McLaughlin.
Question to the manager. What level of funding for state revenue sharing for the municipality is involved here with your $200,000 figure?
I didn't bring that particular number with me. One of the problems is that I first kind of thought when I prepared lists that we would get 3.1% the rest of the year instead of 5.1%. Ultimately, excuse me, after the governor spoke, it ended up higher than that. What my sense is the revenue sharing amount, you know, if you tried to add the 100,000 plus the other 100, excuse me, you could say revenue sharing is just 100 and the other is another 100. But what's happening is, as I mentioned in my preface this evening, there are so many things happening right now, and they're all going in the wrong direction. So it's a very fluid situation, and the only thing that's going right at all is that the rank and file in the legislature recognizes the problem. But when I look at, you know, investment income, excise tax, everything is in a free fall. Did I answer your question?
Well, no, but how possible, I don't know if anyone can answer this, but is it likely that we're going to have to cut more than this amount if we get zero from the state starting January 1st?
I would not plan to come back to the council during this fiscal year with any additional cuts. Let me take a word out. I will not come back to the council this fiscal year with any additional cuts. You know, we're already getting our revenue estimates. You know, I feel like I don't want to fall in the same trap as you know who.
Yes, sir.
No, this is it for this fiscal year, and anything else that we may need to reduce. Again, we have excellent department heads, and you know, we can nickel and dime here and there, but I don't anticipate that that will need to occur.
So this would be the worst possible scenario?
That's right. There may be a few areas that are down, but, you know, state revenue sharing, we did better last month slightly than we anticipated. The one revenue that showed any promise is the one that is proposed to be eliminated. So, you know, frustrating as much as anything else.
Councilor Jordan.
So a question to the manager. These cuts here, as I understand you, that we're not going to have to cut any services as far as the department heads. The roads are all going to be plowed, sanded, solid. The police department is going to have two cars on the road. The fire department is going to answer the calls. The code enforcement officer is going to be in business. And the assessor is going to be in his office. He's going to have a secretary. Is there any of those areas they may have to cut back on a little paper? And I'm going to recommend that next year anyway, because I don't think I need to get two or three memos. I can bring last month's memos to the next meeting if it's possible without making other copies. And I think we could save a few dollars there.
I think we have been doing that, haven't we? With
yes.
To try and do that. To answer your question, you know, we'll still, with this, you know, we may have to say no to some tree maintenance. You know, Buster won't be around anymore. The Conservation Commission won't be able to do some of the signage that they wanted to do. The Arts Commission may not be able to put on all the programs that they wanted to. Family Fun Day is going to have to cut back on some of their different activities. The fire department, you know, there may be a time when it would have been nice to have a deputy in town, and, you know, hopefully the captains will step forward, and I'm sure they will, but, you know, it's one less person. But yes, we'll put out the fires. Your contingency is wiped out. I can't tell you, you know, what that means. But, you know, the major thing here is your roadway drainage account. You know, you had the money there for Shore Road shoulder improvements, but, you know, as I mentioned earlier, look at the condition of Shore Road. Look at the condition of Fowler Road out beyond Annie Murray's house out to Sprague Hall. You know, I could show you all over town when the crazy winters we've had the last few years with thawing and freezing have done a job on the roads, and this is extremely painful to cut. Not so much for Shore Road, because, you know, I think the council all realizes that has never been a high priority for me, the shoulder improvements. But, you know, just to take that cut from that roadway drainage account is very, very painful, because the roads are really beginning to deteriorate as a result of particularly the weather.
So after listening to you, I guess I should withdraw my motion and get the second withdrawn and leave it all in there.
We need to make cuts, Councilor
okay.
Jordan, and I don't take
and
that.
And you've got a list of them. And we got to bite the bullet sometime. Why don't we do it now? And
that's
as you presented this and we workshopped it, everybody kind of agreed that we could get by this way. Why don't we adopt it?
We do have a motion. We do have a second.
Another question.